Good evening and welcome to our second online broadcast presentation for Music from the Western Reserve's 38th season. I'm Joel Bognar, the Artistic Director and General Manager for the series. Thank you so much. We're glad that you're here. So tonight we have a wonderful presentation. We have Nathaniel Silberschlag, who is the principal horn of the Cleveland Orchestra. We're very excited. He's also joined by over a dozen of his musical colleagues, friends, and even members of his family. Our concert this evening is dedicated to the late Lola Rothman, a founding member of Music from the Western Reserve and its first general manager. Lola was the director of the series when it began in 1983 at Stan Hewitt Hall in Akron, a role she continued until 2003. Her planning and vision brought the finest musicians to the series and established our legacy that is unmatched in the chamber music world. Her influence in the Akron area musical scene is also legendary. She planned concerts for the Children's Concert Society, Tuesday Musical Club, and the Akron Symphony, and collectively she contributed around 60 years of enhancing the musical environment of our area. Lola's contribution to the arts will endure thanks to her many talents, her dedication, and her passion, and her many friends. Tonight's concert is sponsored by John and Debbie Warner, longtime friends and supporters. We are truly grateful. And we are truly grateful to you for tuning in. And I would like to emphasize that your support and your contributions of any size go a long way in ensuring that we can continue to bring these wonderful musical events to you. We've provided links in our description, in our chat, and on our website so that you can find a way to donate. Keep in mind that our usual admission is $20. If you are able to do that, we are so grateful. If you are able to do more, that is even better. But even $5 or $10 makes a huge difference. So we invite you to sit back, grab your favorite beverage, and enjoy tonight's presentation. Well, Nathaniel, good evening, and thank you so much for being on our series, and it's such changed circumstances, and we're really glad that you could join in virtual format.
Thank you so much, Joel, for having me. I'm very excited.
So I'm just so curious to know, first of all, how are you and what have you been up to during the quarantine? Have you been having chances to make music?
Yes, I am. I'm doing, I think, pretty well, all things considered. What have I been up to in quarantine? I'm lucky enough to be coming from a musical family that when I went home to quarantine in March with them, they were like, okay, well, we've got to make some videos, which was really, you know, began to come in handy as classical music has had to shift very virtual as of late. So that's mainly what I've been doing to keep in shape is we did a lot of recording while I was home in Maryland. And now I guess I'm a couple weeks from maybe going back to work. So.
Well, that's really, really encouraging. I haven't been sure about my own concert calendar. You know, everything currently is canceled. And of course, large public gatherings, that's the last to return during this period. And of course, that means for us as musicians, classical music is having a really, really tricky time.
Exactly. So we're lucky. I'm lucky enough to try to get back into Severance and we're trying to do some streams. So hoping for the best.
So one of my favorite things to ask musicians is how they got into music. But I do happen to know, as you mentioned earlier, that you come from a really large musical family.
Yeah. So people always ask me, when did you start playing horn? And to be honest, I have no actual recollection of the exact time because I was so young. My parents tell me I was 3 years old when they basically started to get me start buzzing, et cetera. And they actually had a horn made by the German horn maker Hans Hoyer that was wrapped in extra time. So it was smaller. It was more smaller and more compact because my parents, they've got to get those musicians going early.
So I guess, was it just perfectly inevitable that you would become a musician? Was that the natural thing to do?
You know, it's, you know, people ask, you know, were you pressured into it? And no, actually, it wasn't like my parents tried to keep us in a box of only music. It was quite the opposite. But they did very much, you know, open their world to us and introduce us to everything music. And so my brother and I never say we were forced into music, but it was kind of just not expected, but it was what we knew. It was what we knew what was going on. And so I don't think really in our minds we expected to do anything outside of music, but it was not maliciously pressured onto us.
So for those of us who don't know already, you're the principal horn of the Cleveland Orchestra, but in fact, that's not your first orchestral job that you have ever had.
Correct. Yeah.
And you've played in the DC area.
Yes. I was in my senior year of Juilliard, I was working at the Kennedy Center Opera House Orchestra, right in the Kennedy Center in the heart of DC, which was so fun and really an amazing time period for me. It was almost bittersweet to leave, but I was obviously thrilled to be coming to Cleveland.
I mean, if I remember correctly, your first orchestral position was a hire at the age of 19.
True. Yes.
So most people have just started, you know, their conservatory education or at around that age. What did that feel right. like at that point to already find a prestigious spot that other people would aspire to already?
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely a huge leap in my train of thought. It was hugely instrumental in, you know, honestly preparing me for the Cleveland job. I don't want to say, I've tried to stray away from stressful, but it was obviously very different and very eye-opening. But, you know, I tried to take it one day at a time, and I, you know, with my teacher there, I have many lessons of, you know, how are they going to see me? I'm so young. How are they going to view me? Are they going to accept me? Are they going to trust me? And, you know, the only thought that I could really do anything with was, well, I can only bring the best me and the nicest and kindest me to them. And hopefully that vibe is brought back. And I think so far that's worked out pretty well. But that was really the main piece of advice I got from around me, but also that I've tried to stick to myself, honestly.
How long have you been here in Cleveland? At what point did you come here?
I got here last August, so it's been a little over a year now.
That's wonderful. So what have been your impressions of Cleveland as a music scene? Obviously, we can't have any performances now, but what has it been like connecting with Cleveland area audiences?
It's been fantastic. I always kind of harken back to the Mahler Five that we had earlier in the season, which was obviously a very big moment for me. And I swear that I felt the energy in the room that night in performing. Not only did I feel warm wishes from the orchestra members and obviously everyone I was performing with, but I felt this warm energy in the audience, from the Cleveland audience, that, you know, they were so welcoming and they had such a positive energy that has carried through most performances that I've had in Cleveland so far. It's just, you know, they all wish you the best, honestly. I don't think there's ever a negative soul really in a Cleveland classical music concert, as I think through that night, that energy has carried through at all.
Well, you know, it's interesting because I've been in Cleveland for 20 years now, and I feel biased because it is my home and I love the city so much. But one thing that I've always felt about Cleveland area audiences is that they really listen with open ears, open heart, and they do have some background with the great programs that we hear regularly in this rich musical scene, but there's nothing pretentious about these audiences.
Exactly. I mean,
they're really here to love the music.
Exactly.
So now, speaking about the music, I have to admit that I'm not familiar with horn ensemble repertoire. I'm looking over at this program here and it looks exciting, but I'm really not familiar with, I would say, any of it. I've heard of some of these composers.
And totally.
So maybe if for our audience, we could just do a brief little walkthrough of the program.
Totally.
It looks like the first piece on the program is a piece by Bernard Krall?
Yes.
Okay, so what do we have to know about this piece?
Yes. So the first piece on the program is by German composer Bernard Krull, who was actually a horn player himself. He played in the Berlin Philharmonic and the Munich Radio Symphony, etc. Was a big, prominent freelancer in Germany. This piece, Laudatio, which in Latin translates to praying or praising, is for horn alone. And it really covers the full range of the French horn, with, you know, the bottom of the range to the top of the range. And it's very introspective. And I, myself, I get a lot out of playing the piece. I find it a very meditative experience, honestly. And I think I probably play it a little different every time, as most musicians do with their pieces. But it's a very, very cool piece. I think it's the only piece on the program for a single instrument. It's not often played in the horn repertoire, but it's definitely known, for sure.
And then the next piece, I'm seeing a composer by the name of Mercadante, if I'm pronouncing that correctly.
Yes, correct.
So, and this looks like, so the first one was solo horn, and then it looks like this is a an ensemble piece. What do we have to know about this piece?
Yes. So this is Saverio Mercadante's Fantasia su il Giuramento. I hope I didn't butcher that too hard.
That was beautiful. It sounded like you actually speak the language.
Cool. It is a double concerto for trumpet, horn, and piano accompaniment. Mercadante was a composer in the Risorgimento time period of Italy, where the unification of Italy happened, where also Verdi was a very prominent composer. And this piece actually is kind of a fantasy off of his opera, The Oath. So it's a little, it's kind of a mini opera. It's like a little operetta, I would almost say. But, you know, in this case, we don't have two vocalists. We have a trumpet and a horn as kind of the two lead parts. And it's fun. It's kind of has like some Scena, Arietta aspects to it. I think it's a little bit like a mini Italian opera mixed up in 8 minutes, where the horn and the trumpet are the leads.
Okay, so tell us about the other two performers on this number. I think
we're going
to be hearing from your brother.
Yes, so my brother Zachary Silberschlag is principal trumpet of the Hawaii Symphony in Honolulu, and he will be playing the trumpet part. And then we have a great friend, Lior Willinger, playing piano. He's currently a collaborative pianist at the Peabody Institute. He's also a doctorate candidate. I think he actually already got his doctorate from Peabody. Baltimore-based pianist. So two people, obviously Zach, one of the closest people to me, but Lior as well, very close friend.
So looking here at the next number, it looks like a piece by Jean-François Michel.
Yes, correct. A Swiss composer, Jean-François Michel. This piece, actually, I will not be performing on. I'm going to shed the limelight on my fantastic brother a little bit, and it's for trumpet and piano, same performers as Zach and Lior. It's a very cool piece, this piece, Klezmerelda. As the name suggests, it kind of takes a lot of influences from the Hebrew klezmer music and the Andalusian Spanish dance music. So you'll really hear a lot of aspects of both forms of dance music in this piece. It's a very, very cool piece. It's one of my favorite that I've heard Zach play recently, especially. Jean-François Michel was a Swiss composer, and he also was principal trumpet of the Munich Philharmonic for a time.
By the way, about your brother, is he older, younger?
He's actually 5 years older.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, I believe that he will also be joining in the next number, and it seems like this will be something quite different. Traditional spiritual. So.
So this is a traditional African-American spiritual, Let Us Break Bread, with performers Sherry Fenwick on piano, my father, Jeffrey Silberschlag, and my brother, Zachary Silberschlag, on both trumpets. And then I'll be playing horn. And a very good friend of ours, of the family, Brian Bourne, who was principal trombone of the President's Own Marine Band, I think, for over 30 years. So he's been a longtime friend of my family. Sherry Fenwick is head of the St. Mary's, it's the Southern Maryland Gospel Choir. I'm from Southern Maryland, and I'm from St. Mary's County, where the choir is based. And every year in my dad's usual summer series that, you know, happens in a normal way every year, he always does a collaboration with Sherry and the gospel choir. And so this year we definitely wanted to include some in the digital series. So this one is the traditional spiritual Let Us Break Bread Together. It's a very beautiful piece. It has a big horn feature, especially in the beginning. A lot of fun. It was a lot of fun to play with them. And it was done, you know, distanced in quarantine. Obviously, three of us were living together at the time. But it was actually, I think, all of our first time playing again musically with people I guess that was June. So it had been already a couple months since everything kind of hit the fan in March.
Yeah. Looks like we have three final pieces on the program.
Yes.
Okay. I'm looking at the program. It says that the next one is by Richard Smallwood, a composer I've
not heard of. Yeah. So Richard Smallwood is actually a very prominent composer and pianist in the American gospel community. His composition, Total Praise, is one of his most famous songs. Again, Sherry Fenwick will be playing piano. We're going to add Roy Johnson, who is the percussionist of the Southern Maryland Community Gospel Choir. And actually, a funny tidbit about Sherry and Roy is they're both students of my dad, because my father is head of the music department at St. Mary's College of Maryland, where both Sherry and Roy are graduates from. So we've also known Sherry and Roy a long time with our family, and same performers other than Roy. It's a great, great piece. You're going to hear, I would say you'd hear a nice trumpet solo towards the end by my dad. That has a nice feature. And then the kind of final big piece on the program is Franz Strauss' Introduction, Theme, and Variations for Horn and Piano. Franz Strauss is actually a big name in the horn community, though this piece is pretty unknown. Franz Strauss is more known for his Nocturno, which is a famous horn recital piece, and his concerto. And he also is very much known for being the father of Richard Strauss, the famous.
I was wondering if there were any relationships to the famous composers.
Yes, so Franz is the father of Richard, and Franz himself actually was a horn player. So if you know the famous Till Eulenspiegel, the Richard mm-hmm. Strauss tone poem, that opening is actually Richard modeled that after his father's warm up in the morning. So that opening horn solo is Franz Strauss's warm up that Richard was recalling from hearing it over and over again as a child, which is a very, very cool tidbit.
Oh, that's wonderful. So then some of us might recognize something on the program.
Yes, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's cool, this piece, because you can hear a lot of Richard Strauss influence, but obviously Richard Strauss found the influence from this, in fact, because it came before he wrote anything. It's a very cool piece, and I think I hope that it will begin to be played more custom recitals, et cetera, because Franz Strauss is a household name, but this piece is, for some reason, not.
So I'm looking at the last piece on the program, and I see that it is a piece called Sleep by Eric Whitaker. And I guess the title might answer the question I had. So if we're thinking of large brass ensembles, I guess it's not loud all the time, if we're speaking really lay terms.
Yeah, yes, for sure. This has a very serene feel to the whole picture of the piece. It does have some climactic moments for sure, but the title suggests that it will be a meditative sort of performance. This was a very really fun to put together as part of the Con 8D project that a friend of mine, actually in the Kennedy Center Opera House, Jeffrey Pilkington, kind of, it was a product of quarantine. Of course, you know, we all want to get together and play. And of course, we were actually in the same vicinity, me being in Maryland, him in DC, but we didn't get together because of COVID. But so the idea kind of originated with Jeff and my teacher, Julie Landsman. I'm at Juilliard. She, you know, she said, you know, I want to get the 8D sound. For those that don't know, the con 8D is a type of horn. It's actually the horn we play in the Cleveland Orchestra. Everyone in the section plays con 8Ds. And she was just, our teacher was expressing herself, like, I want to get it out there. I want young students to be able to hear this sound so that they know they, you know, the con 8D is out there. So we got together, you know, I want to say a sort of all-star kind of group of horn players to record virtually from our all separate homes. All eight of us did it in different places. But it was really fun to put together, and Jeff and I produced it and did all the editing. It's a really beautiful piece. Eric Whitaker composed it. Jeff did the arrangement for eight horns. It's originally for eight voices.
Yeah, I was familiar with some of his choral works. They're just absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, they're really, really pretty.
Well, I'm really looking forward to this program. And Nathaniel, thank you so much again for joining us with this program during this changed time. Our 38th season, we've suddenly had to take on the huge learning curve of how to put on these virtual productions.
Of course, I'm so happy to be here and so happy to present this recital, for sure.
And best wishes for not just your health and safety, but very much looking forward to your next in-person performances, which will hopefully
be. Thank you, me as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Nathaniel Silberschlag. I am principal horn with the Cleveland Orchestra. The piece that I'm about to play for you is by German composer Bernard Krull, titled Laudatio. Laudatio comes from the Latin word for praying. This piece is for horn alone, and it covers the full range of the French horn, from the top to the bottom of the range. It also uses extended techniques by use of stopped horn, and the composer wanted the horn player to really take big, grand pauses in between phrases. Something to look out for and listen to is the descending half-step motif that begins the piece and ends the piece, and you'll be able to hear it throughout the piece. I find this piece very meaningful and touching, and I myself find a lot of enjoyment and value of playing the piece, and I hope that you can find some similar value and enjoyment and healing through listening. Thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you enjoy. This is Laudatio by Bernard Krull.
Thank you. Thank you.
On behalf of all of us here at Music from the Western Reserve, we thank you so much for tuning in, and we hope that you've enjoyed what you've heard. And if you have, please consider your free will donation to support the very survival of our series especially during this difficult time, it might be the only source of income for our performing artists. I'm Jolt Bognar, the artistic director and general manager of the series, thanking you for tuning in. See you next time.